Good evening, everyone, and welcome to our December Benedictine conversation entitled Creativity Nourishes the Soul. I'm Dawn Carrillo. I'm the director of the Center for Spirituality and Enrichment, which is a ministry of the Sisters of Saint Scholastica. And I'm delighted to welcome you all here on the winter solstice. And we're in our last week of Advent as we come close to the Christmas celebrations. We are going to have the same format that we have had in prior Benedictine conversations, where our guest will be engaging in conversation with me. And if you have any sorts of questions or comments during this time, please feel free to send them in through the chat function. I'll be watching for that on my screen. And I'll also invite people at a point further on in the conversation to please add in any kind of questions or comments that you'd like to. You probably would have the best viewing experience if you would switch your view to speaker view on your Zoom window. It's usually up in the top right corner, but it's different for different screens, I hear. So I am delighted also to welcome Barbara Sutton with us here tonight. Barbara comes to us from central Minnesota. She lives in Sauk Rapids, which is a suburb of St. Cloud. Barbara has spent her career working in healthcare in various ministry settings, and most recently, she completed 14 years at St. John's School of Theology in Collegeville, Minnesota, as the Director of Field Education and Ministerial Formation, where she also taught courses in pastoral ministry. Barbara is now the director of a new initiative in her area. She's the director of the Bridge Building for a Thriving Mission, which is a collaborative endeavor between St. John's Abbey, St. John's School of Theology and Seminary, and the Diocese of St. Cloud. She works extensively with the illuminations from the St. John's Bible through retreats, workshops, publications, and preaching. And starting about a year ago, Barbara has hosted a monthly soul collage group here for us at the Center for Spirituality and Enrichment, which has been a wonderful addition to our offerings. Barbara's cultivated her own spiritual practices using the expressive arts, and this has led her to teaching and sharing these practices with hundreds of other people, including myself. She's passionate, she's wonderfully creative, and a thoughtful innovator who is deeply grounded in her calling to help others develop their spirituality and understanding of our life in God. I personally am grateful to have had Barbara as a mentor, as a cherished colleague, and as a friend for about 13 years now. And I'm most honored to welcome her with us this evening. Barbara, welcome. Thank you.
Thank you, Dawn. It's good to be here.
Yeah. So we begin with prayer, and I believe that Barbara has a special little experience for us. So I am going to pull up the PowerPoint for this.
Right. Well, it's really good to be here with all of you, and as these days as we prepare in a special way for Christmas. And so I'm pulling up the birth of Christ illumination. And I think many of you have done this process and probably know the scripture by heart. So tonight, part of our time together is really to talk about how to see And the process that we're going to use is a sacred gaze, and to fix our eyes on this illumination and just empty yourself into this manger and to make space in your own heart. You don't have to watch, look, or take, but just be with this illumination. And so let us pray. Lord Jesus, help our eyes search toward the light of your coming. Lead us by your light as we long for the light of the radiant eternal dawn. Guide our steps so that we too may shine in your love for your glory. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. That was beautiful, Barbara. You know, I'm struck by noticing that you have a particular lens in practice when you speak about this topic, creativity nourishes the soul. And it's about the way you see, the way you use voice. Could you tell us more about this?
Yeah, I think, you know, when we just fixed our gaze on this illumination, it's a particular kind of looking. It's steady, intense, we're absorbed in it, and we hold it lightly and we give it space. We don't hold it to one form. And so we turn it over and over from various angles, and we ruminate on it. And so when we think about these artistic processes, we never know what's going to emerge from it. It's a mystery, it's a surprise. And this particular process is belongs to the Benedictines. It's the process we use for Lectio and Visio Divina. And so tonight I will explain some of the modalities that I use, but it really is that ancient practice of Lectio Divina, of hearing the word, meditating on images, contemplating them, right? Praying with them and seeing what it calls us to. And so it's that process that is consistent with these images and whatever form we use. And we know in the literal sense, you know, when we're praying with the scripture, is that we try to get into the voice of the scripture. We want to know the story behind the scripture, the story in front of it, who it was written to, when, why, and all those things, so that we know the voice of the scripture. We can do the same thing with the images, is what is the voice emerging in these images? So, yeah, so that's kind of the underlying part of this. And one of the hard things about explaining it is you can't nail it down. So I remember when I was working with the St. John's Bible and the seeing the word process, I was working with Irene Knoll, and I was a baby fledgling. What the heck am I doing? One of those things you get asked to do something and go, I have to learn about it more. And I would just test Irene with all these questions and what to do. And she took my hand and she slapped it and she said, you can't nail this down. And so I let go. So that's part of the process, is let go and let God emerge in the process. Mm. Yeah. So I don't know. I think I want you to pull the PowerPoint slides back up. When Dawn and I were talking earlier today, I said, I don't want to use all words to talk about images. So I have some images that I'll use with you and kind of walk you through some of the process to give you an idea of what it is. So we went through Visio, or a very short sliver of Visio. The other process that I'll break open tonight, one of them is the soul collage process that I do on one Sunday a month at in Faith Scholastica on Zoom. But the process of soul collage is really about letting images speak. And so we create collages on a little 5x7 chipboard, and we don't have to have a purpose for them when we do it, but they're usually things we're attracted to, about 3 images. And then, as we would in the literal sense, we allow the images to begin to speak. And sometimes they stay silent for a while. But in their speaking, we ask them questions. And so the question is answered in the eye. So the questions I would ask a card is, who are you? What do you have to give me? What do you want from me? And is there anything else you want to say to me today? And so we use the I am the one. What I give you, my gift to you, I want you to, what do you want from me? And so these are prompts to get the voice out of the card. So what I am going to do is have Dawn go to the next one, and I'm going to read my prompts on this. And this really comes from, so this is all connected. So oftentimes I start with an illumination of the St. John's Bible to inspire me or others, or I'll use a poem or a short writing. But this comes from a reflection on the birth of Christ, about the manger. Mm-hmm. And when you looked at the birth of Christ, I'm wondering if you saw anything new or were puzzled by it. Most people want to know, where's the baby? You know, and well, the baby is reflected in our faces, in the faces of the shepherds and the angel. So Christ is among us and dwells with us. Oftentimes people think those in the left-hand side of the cross is shepherds, but those shepherds are women. So the early shepherds were women and not men. So that's one way that art can disrupt us, and that is archaeologically sound. And so thinking about that, even that gold bar in that manger that connects heaven and earth, we all have those moments of heaven and earth connecting. When someone dies, when someone sees darkness and then sees light, we all have those gold bars in our lives that mean different things. But this is the image, the soul collage card that I made. And you can just see it has probably 3 pictures in there that were glued together. So I'll read this to you. I am the innkeeper. I am the one who gathers us in, sojourners and friends. I am the one who invites you to stay a while, to kindle the many fires, to break bread, and to taste the sweetness of fondness and community. I give you a circle to see eye to eye and soul to soul. I dwell here. I need safe space and room for meaningful conversations and to bear the light of Christ for one another. So you can see the rhythm that I use, that I am the one, I give you, I need from you. And so every card has light and shadow in it.
So the idea with this is that you are speaking from one of the places within yourself, reflecting on this, and who am I and what do I need and what do I give?
Yeah. Beautiful. Yeah. Thanks for that, Dawn. And I just, this would be a good time to just help people understand that in soul collage, there's a deck of cards. And in the process, there are many voices, and the voices can come from my psychological things running around my mind. It can come from my community, which could be my family, my friends, mentors. It could be the great council of people, the archetypes of artists, fool, mother, so things like that. Or it could be from companions in our energy sources in our body. And by companions, I mean our animal friends. And so we pull our voices from those four areas. Why I love this process is because I grew up in a family of 9 children, many brothers, and I never felt my life was fair because my brothers always got whatever they wanted. And so I kind of lost my voice in that. And so growing up from young adult to adult, I would always like say things aren't fair. I'd whine. I don't like this. I want this. And, you know, stamp my feet kind of thing. When Soul Collage came along, it helped me to understand I have many voices within me to access, not just the whiny, unfair sister one. And so it really has opened up for me this great place of joy and accessing voices that I've never used to describe things. And it really opens up for me a horizon that wasn't part of the first part of my life. So that's why it is important to me. I think it's healing to be able to find those different voices, to use them, and to use them reverently with other people. Yeah, yeah. So our next slide, unless you have a question, Dawn.
No.
So I wanted to show you, this is also a response to the birth of Christ. And this is a process. So here we have in the middle, a friend of mine, Jean. And Jean was sick for 10 years with a brain tumor. And for the last 5 years of her life, she lived in a nursing home. And so one of the things I would do with her is to take pictures in, and we would make collages. And Jean didn't talk that much. She was aphasic. And so we could put things together, and they were her images. So what happened was her second grandchild was born, Reuben. And Jean was a nurse practitioner, OBGYN, and there was no place she would have rather have been than beside her daughter when this baby was born. So I brought these in and said, let's make Reuben a card, a soul collage card. So we prayed with the birth of Christ illumination, talked about it, and then she picked out images. I cut them for her, and we glued them down. And this is the words that I put together from the words she used when she wrote it. I am Grandma Bear, and now there are two, the oldest and the youngest. I give you wide angel wings to carry you in my heart forever. I give you prayers and love and hugs with one another. I need you to play patty cake and read Thumbelina and reach for the sky. And remember, God loves you. So this is the card that she gave Reuben and for his birth and for Annie, their daughter, and David. So this is interesting. They're holding a soul collage card. This is Jean's husband, Tim. And this was on their anniversary. So I gave them a soul collage packet to make something for their anniversary. So they made a anniversary card there. But I wanted to show their pictures so that they were more than a soul collage card, to kind of pass that microphone to their voice. But what became important with this card is that Jean passed away a year and a half ago. And when she was at Quiet Oaks in hospice, the family had asked me to do some rituals with them. And I thought, what should I do? So one of the things I did was to bring this picture, soul collage, with me, because one of the things that the family said many times is they wish they knew what Jean was thinking, because she was aphasic and didn't have many words. And so I thought, I'm going to bring the soul collage cards with me. And so in our prayer, I said, I know you've all wanted to know more about what your mom has been saying and thinking. And so I said, I have her voice here. Mm. I am Grandma Bear. So we read that, and it kind of brought them back to who she is and who she was for them and the kids. So it really is, you know, that started from the birth of Christ, right? Mm-hmm. And then it turns into a community event, a healing moment, and a way to share a voice when she didn't have much of a voice that could speak aloud at that time. So
beautiful.
Do we want to go on to the next?
Sure.
So this, I'm going to just move a little into photo voice, which is another medium that I use. I had the lovely opportunity of taking this course in England, except that I was in my basement during COVID. Everyone else was from England, so I really wanted to go to England. But photo voice is an opportunity to use your images, your pictures on your phone or wherever to tell a common story. So photo voice was designed as a qualitative research method. And so people were doing research in Africa, and they found themselves imputing words and thoughts for people and that weren't tested. And so what they decided to do is to buy people a little box camera, and they gave people cameras and gave them questions. Where do you find hope? Where do you need something? And people would take pictures, and then they would develop it, and people would talk about the pictures from their voice, their experience, their backyard. And so the researchers could use that firsthand story for their research. So it's beautiful. Yeah. So I want to practice this with everyone if I can for a minute. So I want you to look at this image. And one of the things we talked about with the birth of Christ is being a Christ bearer. So if you could use the chat, this is a short exercise, but would you look at this image and see what it tells you about being a Christ bearer, and put that in the chat. Do I see the chat, or is that for you, Dawn?
Well, you've got it too. It's okay. Just up above when you're screen sharing. So if everyone could access their chat and send in some thoughts on this, that would be wonderful. So Barbara, when you're talking about evoking something in us about being a Christ bearer, you're talking about a bearer of light, right? So what does this evoke in you about being a bearer of that light of Christ? There's no wrong answers.
Yeah, so it's about, it could be light, and it could be witness, it could be testimony, but what does it tell you about Christ who dwells among us?
We have one comment. She says, it invites me to engage.
I have one here from Sister Teresa. Bearing Christ means not mistaking people for garbage tossed aside and ignored. I don't know about me and my bar, but you might. Oh, one new. I cannot hide from God's gaze. Mm-hmm. Do I see the world with love? So as you, I'll let you continue to do that. One of the things when I look at this and think about being a Christ bearer, I say, who's, you know, because with photo voice, with pictures, we can cut out people, show small glimpses. And this one, I think, who's bearing Christ? the person looking in or the person sleeping beside the street or the people reflected here. So who are the Christ bearers and how are they bearing Christ? And can I see these people bearing Christ and this person bearing Christ? Because we all bear Christ. It's not reserved for the onlookers. So why don't we, you want to move on, Dawn?
Sure.
So a question that Dawn asked me earlier as I was preparing for this is about how have I been changed by these illuminations? What does it do for my own spirituality? And one of the things I thought a lot about, and this just happened 2 weeks ago, and doing Visio Divina usually makes me reinterpret what's going on around me and beside me. And so this illumination, I was praying with about 14 people a couple weeks ago, and we were doing some work on interculturality. And it dawned on me in my prayer that this Jesus is brown. And I've always been praying in my head with a white Jesus. And I thought, what does it mean for me to do theology with a brown Jesus? Because it's different.
How is it different, right?
Yeah, it's different because I think of, so it's about grounding. It's about, so one of the things I was thinking of, because I'm working on this bridge building grant is, you know, when our Somali neighbors come to this country, they come by water or plane and they get off, and this horizon that they're welcome to is so wholly different. And they don't go over the bridge. They usually go under the bridge. And so, you know, I thought about how their lives are so different from mine. And this brown Jesus, what does that bring to a discussion on interculturality? And I was led to Patrick Race, who I use as a textbook in my Ministry on the Margins class. And Patrick talks about the theology of the soil. Patrick is a Latino theologian. And he talked about grounding, which was new. And so this is a way that I'm looking at this illumination from just an agricultural plant the seed. Does it grow? How much did it reap? To an illumination of justice. And so in a theology of the soil, Patrick Race would say, the deep grounding often works for those who hear gunshots going off at night, who have never heard the whiz of bullets, who have never had to struggle to breathe as the life is being choked out of them. It works for those who trust complete strangers with their bodies. And so when people don't feel safe, when people have been harmed and people have lost their voice and people are standing at a border waiting to get across, right? This is a whole different illumination. And so for me, I did have to ask myself why I never saw that he was brown. And now that I understand Christ is a Latino man or a Middle Eastern man, does it change how I interpret scripture?
So I wonder if you could give us an example here. This is the parable of the sower and the seed. So how do you interpret that in a different way when you think about this grounding that doesn't work for so much of the world? Yeah.
You know, one of the ways is I just saw something on the news this morning, but there are so many people that are harvesting our crops and so many people working in food industry, and they're standing at in lines at the food shelter. Okay. And so the work they do, they are not even sustained by that food for their own health.
Mm-hmm.
And so how do we pay attention? So the ground of the being for many people of color is not solid.
Right.
And so, you know, I have to ask, for me as a white woman, what are the footprints I'm leaving in the soil? And who am I walking along beside? So in it, you know, I have to stop looking for my own footprints and seeing that a person of color might walk someplace different in a way that I don't. Yeah. So it's just finding myself called in a way. So Visio Divina is not for me alone. It's not a pious spirituality. It is in our seeing that we're called to compassionate action. And one of the things, thanks for that question. One of the things that causes me, pushes me to, is to have a real encounter. So here I can see Christ with the basket spreading the seeds. But how do I encounter Christ in another eye to eye, voice to voice? So, you know, sometimes I say we're all pharmacists. I want to get to know the brown Christ here. I want to get to know someone who's wholly different than me. I'll read about it in a textbook. Or I'll see it in this illumination, and I never sit down to have the conversation. And it's not just a conversation to learn about them, but also for them to know me. And so that's the mutuality of encounter. You know, I have my own vulnerabilities, my own protections, you know, and so how do we share mutually in that? So does that help?
You're talking about coming out of our own little bubble, and we interpret scripture within that bubble. And so, and this is one of the practices that many people, and all our Benedictine conversation guests this year, when I asked them, how do we practice what we're talking about here? And you've just said what everyone says: look for these encounters, look for Christ in the other, look for ways of getting to know the other. We're not comfortable.
I'm gonna tell you a story, and it was very moving to me early on in my work with the St. John's Bible and the artistic process. But the Visitation Sisters in North Minneapolis have a Mother's Day weekend retreat for people in the neighborhood, and so I and one of my students, Doris Law, were invited to do it. And so we used illuminations. There's like 60 people there. And so they were divided into small groups. So this is like a 48-hour retreat and a 48-hour Visio Divina experience. And so one of the first things we asked them to do was to act out the scripture that they had. And this one young woman got up, and she was acting out the woman caught in adultery. And she got up and acted it out, and very physically and sexually. And I just made a note of that, observing, like I did all of the others, because I was trying to, I knew there was a story behind each person. And so at lunch, one of the sisters mentioned to me that she had had her third baby, this woman that was acting out the woman caught in adultery, and she didn't know for sure who the father was. It was one of three men, and she, if it was one particular one, She didn't want the baby. And so she ended up giving the baby up for adoption. So a few days before this began. And so over the weekend, you know, people bonded and more seeing and caring and those types of things happened in the midst of a community. Well, a week later, the sister called me and said, do you remember the woman who acted out caught in adultery? And I said, yeah. And she says, you're not going to believe this. She says she went back to the adoption agency and asked for her baby back. Wow. Because it was the first time in her life she ever felt loved by God and loved by a community who could support her on this journey. So that, John, is what seeing with the eyes of faith does. And the seeing happens in the midst of community, because then we begin to see together differently.
Mm-hmm.
And so that was such a profound experience for me to think that happened in 48 hours. And, you know, she heard the word of God, felt the love of community, and knew she could move forward. You know,
well, you know, it harkens to this last line of Patrick Reyes. It works for those who trust complete strangers with their bodies. So she had learned to trust these people she was with. Wow. She became grounded, is what you're saying. Wow. Yeah.
I think we're moving to the next one.
Yep.
Well, this is just a response from me after, really after the George Floyd murder and doing some of my own visio and spirituality and really having an accountability group for interculturality is I wanted to explore an image of a Black Christ as a woman.
Hmm.
And so in Soul Collage, we have three cards that don't speak, and they usually are Creator, Redeemer, Holy Spirit, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, Sanctifier. You can use the different language, but I worked with this image of a Black Christ, a female Black Christ, and she's situated right in the field and new life. So when you make God cards, they don't speak, so I can't because like you can't impute your own thing onto God, your own image and words. But this woman gives me great comfort. I can just say that. And I have her right here, actually, you know, I love having her there as a way of seeing deeper into God's life for me. Yeah.
And into how God sees. Yeah.
Yeah. Do you have a question on this, Don?
Well, I want to hear what you have to say about this. I love it.
Yeah. One of the things Don had asked me to think about is beauty. And I had this card I used in 2019 with my Sunday Soul Collage group. We did a whole year on beauty. And this is called, I Am the One Who Seeks Advent Beauty. So you can see the different images here. Little points to the mule, licking someone's hand in the coffee cup. But to gain the voice is always, we begin again, to discover divine kindness. I am the one who is on watch for the visitation, where all life becomes beautiful. I am the one who welcomes the donkey in you and me, because surprisingly, we too can be Christ bearers. I am the one who gives you my delight, my sacred gaze, and a chance to ponder. I am the one who needs a creative spirit to push through the contradictions of this world. I need to trust the latent blessings that come as Christmas light. So yeah, so part of, I know you've worked on beauty for the last few Benedictine conversations and...
Right. It's actually for this whole year, we're kind of exploring that connection between beauty and justice. I love the line here. I am the one who needs a creative spirit to push through the contradictions of this world. So I'm wondering, we have a lot of contradictions in the world going on right now. And I deeply have felt the need for creativity and that creative spirit to help me through the darkness and so forth. So I guess what I'd like to ask you is this idea of beauty. Our first speaker in September he makes the case that beauty is our vocation. Mm. So you spent a year on beauty with these people. So beauty being our vocation, because it opens us to a way of seeing the world that is more like God sees. So I'm just wondering if you have thoughts about that, what you think about that.
Well, we're custodians of this world. And so beauty, you know, John O'Donohue's book on beauty would say, God is beauty. Beauty is God. And, you know, how do we show the world God through beauty? Mm-hmm. That we touch that beauty so that we can see the inbreaking of God.
Sometimes it's almost that we're quiet and attentive enough to even notice that beauty. That's a huge piece of it too, I think, in our modern world.
Yeah, and I have something to say about that, in the you know, I came to the St. John's Bible Soul Collage and Photo Voice accidentally. Mm-hmm. Because there was a need to use artistic processes for my work, and they were natural. I love them. But when we talk about the despair in the world and the darkness, so part of this for me is exactly what you said about the mindfulness, is that 4 years ago, I was in an automobile accident and had a mild traumatic brain injury and ended up in brain rehab for 18 months with OT, PT, and speech pathology. And the thing I learned there is about the brain and the resiliency of the brain. And so we can change the brain if we do our work, the neural patterns. Now, it's more complex than what I'm saying, but some of the work that I had to do was to slow down, become more mindful, kind, gratitude. So these positive emotions can help remap the brain. Hmm. So our brain has an affinity for the negative. Hmm. And so I had to work on reversing my pathways, and that might not be the way to say it. And the only way that that was going to work for me is to change my attitude and to practice more loving kindness, to suspend judgment and those types of things. So a lot of that happened in the artistic processes because they made me stop. Hmm. When I am doing soul collage, I surrender judgment because the images are images and they'll evolve for me. So what's interesting about the brain is, you know, we've said for so many years, left brain, right brain. Well, I think what neuroscience teaches us now is about lower brain and upper brain, because our prefrontal cortex, you know, nurtures and mentors and humors the amygdala. And that's really, if we can't find the joy and work towards that when everything says be negative, attached to the negative, right? So this process for me is artistic, but it's also for my own brain health.
Hmm.
Wow. So that's just another side of this that is meaningful for me.
That's wonderful. I just want to pause here and invite anyone out there to send in any questions or comments through the chat. It's time for those questions and comments, and I know Barbara would love to hear what you have to say, so go ahead and send them in. And so seeking beauty, it's like so holistic what you're talking about. It affects all our processes. And I think it seems to naturally open us to the perspective of justice because of that. When we stop, when we see, when we notice, something different happens inside us. Yeah. Do you want to go on to the next one now, Barbara?
That prompts me. So I had Maria Kuzo, who's a friend of the sisters at St. Scholastica's in our Sunday Soul Collage. And, she said something earlier in the month about how we were processing what the year had been like. And she said, I made 124 cards this year. And she said, it was my documentary of my life during the pandemic. Mm-hmm. And so yesterday I, had a long chat with her, and she said she needed creativity during the pandemic. And this, so this is a tip of her hat to the sisters. She says, I just trust the sisters. Whatever they are having and hosting, and I think that includes you, Dawn, is that she trusts it. And so she got involved in it, and she had to work through some of her own issues with the pandemic. And she just said when darkness showed up, light showed up, and the beauty of a community to process all of that. But I was just so taken by 124 cards. Wow. That are a documentary of the pandemic.
Well, I'm also struck with, because I lead a lot of Visio Divina too, and that you taught me well. Thank you, Barbara. But when I think about all those illuminations, it's a phenomenal, it puts light and dark together in ways that helps you make sense of pain and darkness in light, in our lives, but in a way that the light is there too. It just helps us to see pain and darkness differently.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, and the thing is, we don't even know it oftentimes when we're making the card. And then, it's not linear. Something will emerge and draw us in. And oftentimes people will say, where'd that come from? A funny story Maria told me is, because she, was trying to figure out the process, and she did it well. But she asked me to send her a bunch of pictures, images, because I have a stack of them. And it was the theme this past year was on doors. And so I guess I didn't even think about doors when I did it. So I sent her a whole bunch of images. And she said to me yesterday, the theme was doors. And I opened up the box of images and there wasn't one door in it. And, it was kind of funny. And she said, then all of a sudden there's doors all around me and they don't look like doors. So it's just the beauty of the metaphor.
Yeah.
And the thresholds we cross and the door to our heart. And yeah, it's fascinating.
Wow. Learning to live in metaphor. Wow.
Yeah. I think it's sacramental and mystery. Yeah. Yeah.
It seems that way. Yeah. I agree.
Do we have questions or?
We haven't gotten any yet. Do you have any on your end? Oh, here's one. Here we go. Greg Spofford says, thanks for your openness and vulnerability. Can you say more about how gratitude repairs the neuro pathways?
Yeah. Thanks, Greg, for that. But gratitude is a positive emotion. And so the positive emotions help heal the neural traps that we get caught in. So we're focused on the positive. When naturally we would be tethered to the negative. So what happens, and this is scientific. So I did training on resiliency from the Mayo Clinic. So my gratitude practice is that before I get out of bed in the morning, I pick three people and offer them gratitude. Now, they could be people I'm going to see today. It could be this group tonight, but I offer gratitude for three people. And it prepares me for the day. Yeah. The one thing is my cell phone is not the first thing I look at in the morning. It's that I have claimed some of that time for myself. And it shapes my day. And the other part of this, Greg, that it was helpful for me is because I can get tangled up in judgment. And sometimes I think I have to figure it out or answer the person or all that stuff, the fixer. And when someone says something to me, oftentimes now I just smile and say under my breath, I wish you well. And so I'm extending positive energy out to them instead of rehearsing the thoughts. And so letting that go. Yeah. So part of it is that nurtures the prefrontal cortex, which is the mentor for the amygdala, which is a police officer and always on alert for the negative. So I'm working on the prefrontal cortex and more humor. So I hope that helps. And so I think to correlate that with the images are, you know, if writing these types of things, if images, you know, they just help me see God and see the community and really begin to respect the different voices that emerge in me. And listening to others read their cards is really about appreciating others and not judging. So in soul collage, you can't read another person's card because it's their voice. So you just receive it.
Angel, quiet.
That's wonderful. You know, Barbara, I wonder if you can clarify for us. I say this a lot, but there may be people out there that are not familiar with the phrase, but we talk about seeing with the eyes of God. What does that mean to you?
Yeah. It's a spiritual sense. It's seeing each person and the dignity of the human person, and that we're made in the image and likeness of God, every single one of us. And so when I look at this mule, which I love my line, because surprisingly, we too can be Christ bearers, even when we're a jackass, right? So we can be Christ bearers, and to see each other with the dignity and love that God has given us. And that God has created every one of us good. And there's so many people that don't believe that about themselves. And so when we can be that for someone else, we're giving dignity and love and kindness.
Which is what God does.
Yes.
Yeah. Exactly.
You know, this I was thinking about these contemplative practices, Dawn, of seeing. And I think about growing up and how I learned to pray. And since it's Christmas time, I think one of my best kind of prayers was to keep a list for Santa or keep a list for God, checking it twice and asking for it. It's like that was my prayer, you know, keeping a list for Santa, keeping a list for God type thing. Or, you know, a checklist. Someone says, pray for me. Okay, I prayed for you. But this process for me, and that works for some people, for me, I feel like I enter into the life of God and am called forth into something new. And so it helps me build my memory of who mm-hmm. I'm called to be.
Wow. Build my memory of who I'm called to be. That's beautiful. I'm aware that we are getting close to time. Our time has flown by tonight. This next one, Barbara, do you want to say something about this one?
So one of the things that when John and I were planning this is to think about how to involve people in images. And one of the things that I want to do just to close out the night is which image. I want you to look at these four images, and I want you to think about what image reflects. Oh, I should learn how to write, right? What image
reflects for you?
For you a glimpse of a new heaven and a new earth. So think about those four. This is another 1 minute thing, and you can just type 1, 2, 3, or 4 in the chat. Or you can say why you chose one, or you can put your own image in. But when you start imagining a new heaven and a new earth, what image would you hold up? Because holding up that image helps us to see it, imagine it, become mm-hmm. it.
Mm-hmm.
Two.
So in number two, yeah. I think I'd have to choose number four.
Thanks, Craig. One.
Nice. That's the lovely one too.
Yeah, we have a few people here from the Sunday Soul Collage. So welcome. I appreciate you being here.
The guitar from Sister Therese. The guitar, when we learn to sing with the voice of God, our world is transformed.
Mm-hmm.
Beautiful. I'll watch and see if more come in, but yeah. Did you get any more on your end?
No.
Okay.
No, I don't think so.
Okay. So, I'm aware that we need to close out for the evening. I just want to thank everyone for being here. Thank you so much. It's been wonderful, Barbara. So much food for thought. I'm going to have to sit with this for a while and do my own seeing and recollecting and so forth. So thank you so much. I just want to let everybody know, our next Benedictine conversation is going to be on January 18th, where we are going to have Sarah Brocky Erickson, who is an art professor from the College of St. Scholastica. And that registration link will be up on our website soon. And to turn back to you, Barbara, and just thank you. Thank you for this work that you do. Thank you for all you bring to so many people, new ways of seeing, new ways of knowing, new ways of coming into the self more deeply. That's what your processes do for me. And I do thank you. Although I haven't, I've done a little soul collage with you and I haven't done photo voice. That'd be fun sometime. So I'm just curious, are there Any last words, or I think you have an image that you want to show at for the end, right?
Yeah, yeah.
You'd like me to bring that up now?
I appreciate that, yeah.
Okay.
So I have, yeah. Before I read that, I have a quote from Henry Nouwen, and I keep near my desk that I like, and I think it's a fitting thought for us during Advent. And Nouwen writes, "The Lord is coming, always coming. When you have ears to hear and eyes to see, you will recognize him at any moment of your life. Life is Advent. Life is recognizing the coming of the Lord."
That's cool.
So these are my words. Those were Nouwen's words. So this is, I want to end with this. One of the things I've done in the past year is start using people of color in my own collages and making them available to others. And so I love this little girl. I love her to death. And so this is what I wrote about her. And I think it's for all of us as we push through the light to Christmas. And this is it. "I am the one who is yellow. I am the one who's going to push through to the light I was born with. I am the one who wants to color the world with peace. I am the one who gives you a push and a prompt to use all the colors. I need you to not be afraid to pick up a new color." God bless. Thank you for staying with me, and appreciate it, Dawn, and all your work to make this happen.
Yeah, thank you, Barbara. This was just so lovely. And I just want to tell you and everyone with us tonight that on behalf of the Sisters of St. Scholastica and the Center for Spirituality and Enrichment, everyone here with us tonight, we wish you and your loved ones a lovely Christmas holiday, a joy-filled new year.